Good morning, everyone. Just want you to know I came from the gym area. The lights are fixed. And we need to thank this man in the back, Mr. John English. No more do you have to go to the electric box and turn those lights on. But buddy, when you press that button to turn on the lights, you better have some of these. Okay? Thank you so much. It's awesome. All right. Grab those bulletins. Welcome, everyone. Good to see you all here for worship. Quickly, show off your smiles to at least, let's do three. The good old three, the Trinity. Go. All right, hopefully you've looked over the bulletin. You know what's going on, and I can just go sit down. No, that's not how it works here. I am going to highlight a few things. Youth, come back. 5 o'clock this afternoon, we're going to meet upstairs, but also bring your artsy pants because we're going to make some art tonight. It's not going to be too difficult, but it'll be fun. 5 o'clock. All right. You might have seen on the wall, there's a slide for lunch in a couple of weeks. On the 15th of October, we're all going to have a meal together after the service. In the morning, and that is because the nominations committee would like you to meet and just eat. You know, we do it well here. But there's also going to be a form that they would like for you to fill out, the time stewardship form. It's that time again. But I want you to really be thinking and praying about ways that you can serve here at the church. This place, it just can't happen without us working together for our Lord. So be thinking about how you would want to serve and come to the meal and fill out that form. And also there's some other meetings coming up if you look there for upcoming events and some other information there about meetings. So read up on that. Make sure that you are part of those meetings. And then I want to say a thank you to all of y'all for helping with the bonfire, getting all of the chips. I think we have a few bags of chips left. That's a joke. There's a ton of chips left, and thank you. And there's a ton of Debbie cakes, and there's a ton of drinks. So it's great. Y'all rock it, helping out and giving donations. So we're just going to use that stuff for the Fall Festival, which is coming up. So y'all are already prepared for the Fall Fest. Good job. But thank you. We had a great group of people to show, and they were fed, so that was good. And then right after the service, kiddos, we're going to go straight upstairs. Some of you will already be up there for children's church, but we're going to watch a movie together and eat some delicious chicken nuggets and fries and just hang out. So movie, afternoon, kiddos, right after the service, okay? All right. Now, that's not all that's going on. There's a lot. There's a lot of words in our bulletin today. It should be like 3 or 4 pages. You know, it's good stuff. A lot going on. Read about it, okay? Front and back and upside down, okay? All right, so now let's slow things down and let's say a prayer together as we start the service. Let's pray. Heavenly Lord, we ask that you strengthen us so that we heed your commandments. We pray that we are faithful in the smallest things, that you deem us worthy for more opportunities to serve you. Amen.
Well, praise the Lord. Let's stand as we sing. It's hymn number 354. You'll see the words on the screen if you want to use those. Leaning on the Everlasting Arms. I love this great song. Everybody sing it. Let's sing it. What a fellowship, what a joy divine. Leaning on the everlasting arms, what a blessedness, what a peace is mine. Leaning on the everlasting arms, leaning, safe and secure.
morning, everyone. It's good to be with you all here today. It's such a joy every Sunday to worship together. Before we begin our time of prayer today, I wanted to draw your attention to one other specific thing in the bulletin. We announced this several months ago that much against our wishes and hopes, our dear secretary of 25 years, Peggy Green, had announced that she'd be retiring at the end of the year. The personnel committee has been working to find the new candidate for this position, and we're ready to present Christy McLeod as the next secretary. According to our bylaws, we have to actually vote on that, and so 2 weeks from today, on October 15th, there will be a special called business meeting to confirm, to have a vote to confirm the recommendation of the personnel committee. So if you have any questions about that, we'd be glad to answer them, but we're so excited. We're heartbroken that Peggy does actually have to retire, but we're also excited for Christy and her future service here. So I wanted to share that with you all. But as we do every week, this is the time when we want to pray for the concerns that we have in our church body. We come today, and as I look out, I know people who are experiencing their own health complications or family members and loved ones who have their own. And so, and there are also people who are not here today because of their own health complications. And so we want to spend some time praying for them. But also, and again, Nikki does a wonderful job of beginning this every week after the announcements. We just want to spend time with the Lord in prayer. And to, as we'll talk about later in this worship service today, to gaze upon the beauty of the Lord. And so if you would, please bow your head with me. And let's go to our Lord now in prayer. Lord, you are good, and your mercies endure forever. From everlasting to everlasting, you are God. God, we are thankful that whenever we compare our lives to you, our lives which are mired with frailty and weakness, Father, we know that we are subject to illness, we're subject to sin, we're subject ultimately to death. But God, that is frightful, but God, whenever we look upon you, we see the God who is the creator, with whom there is no error, there is no imperfection, because you are the God who is perfect. You created everything according to your word, according to your will, and it was just as you proclaimed it to be. God, we look to you because we know that you love us, for you sent your son, Jesus Christ, to become a human like us, to die upon the cross for our sins that we might be forgiven, and to raise again from the dead on the third day that we might have eternal life. And now he reigns with you and the Holy Spirit in heaven from your throne. And so, Father, I pray that each of our lives would experience the reign and the mercy of your Son, Jesus Christ, even whenever we experience sickness and illness together, that we would do so knowing that your caring hand is always upon us. You are always with us. Nothing befalls us, which is a surprise to you. And so, God, we pray that you would always tend to us in your mercy. Father, we pray for those who are sick today. We ask that you would be with our church members who can't be here today because of their own health or perhaps the health of a family member. God, we pray that you would give them strength today. We also pray you would bring healing. Father, for those who are grieving this morning, the loss of loved ones, or perhaps the loss of other things in life, we pray that you would be a quick comfort, Father, to each of them, that you would, because you are faithful, dependable, you are the God of all comfort, and so would you draw near to us. You know our need, even greater than we do. Father, as we look outward to the world and we think about the work that you've prepared for us to do, as we think about our neighbors and the world that you created, which we live and work in, God, I pray that you would help us as your people to be the light of the world, as Jesus Christ said, that we would be the salt of the earth. Help us not to lose our saltiness. Help us not to cover the light that you've given us, but rather with our words, with our actions, God, with our time, with our resources, would you help us to bear witness to Jesus Christ, your Son? God, would you give us a vision for the ways in which people are hurting in our community? Father, would you help us to be agents of reconciliation? God, the visions come. They've come to us before. Father, they will continue in our world. But God, you are the God who is one. And you've called us to be peacemakers. Blessed are the peacemakers. And so, Father, we pray you would help us, Father, to be people who are ready and willing to forgive. Help us to be a people who are quick to encourage reconciliation in our communities. God, help us not to be anxious, but to continually trust in your word. Father, as we continue in our time of worship now, as we sing songs, as we pray prayers, as we read from your word and hear it proclaimed, as we give of our tithes and our offerings later in the worship service, God, we pray that you would receive all of this as we consecrate ourselves to you. And we ask this in the name of Jesus Christ, your Son. Amen.
Good morning. Good morning. It's good to see y'all here this morning. Thanks for coming down. I want to show you some pictures. Here's some pictures that I have taken of some places that I've been, but the pictures are of mountains. So here, you see that mountain there? It is from Iceland, and it's a long word, and there's no way I can say it. And there's another, look at that cool mountain. Look at all those peaks. Y'all ever been to a mountain before? We have some of those. Ooh, that one's really cool. That looks like the Grinch lives up there.
That one kind of looks like the North Pole.
Like the North, yeah. And then there's another mountain. Yeah. That mountain's cool. And they do look the same. They are because they're peaks. They all go up high into the sky, right? Yeah. Have y'all ever been on top of a mountain?
No.
Have you ever been to like the Smoky Mountains? Just a hill? We may find a hill. Have you been to Mount Cheehaw? Yes. Maybe Jacksonville Mountain? It's right down the road. You don't need to go. Because taking a picture of a mountain when you're down below looking up, it's fun and all. It's really cool and beautiful. But what's even better is being on top of a mountain. Here's a video of me on top of this mountain in Iceland. Look at, it's scary. I know, you're so high. And look, it's like you could touch the clouds. And you can see for miles and miles. It's such a neat place to be. Oh, really? Y'all have Christmas on your mind, right? North Pole twice already. Yeah. Well, not only is it beautiful up there on top of a mountain, it's a really cool feeling. It's very quiet and peaceful on top of a mountain.
I don't like quiet things.
You don't like quiet things? Well, I do. Because when things are quiet and peaceful on top of that mountain, I feel like I'm really close with God and I can hear and see God better. Now, in the Bible, there's a story of Jesus taking his friends up on top of a mountain. He took Peter, James, and John on this mountain to kind of just get away. Because wherever Jesus was, there was usually a large crowd of people wanting to be touched and healed and wanting to hear what he had to say. So sometimes Jesus would get away and go pray. Well, they go to this mountain on top, and it's not just any regular trip to a mountain. There's some wild things that happen on this mountain. Okay, so Jesus is praying, and then all of a sudden his face like starts to shine. I know. My face only shines when I put certain like products, but that's as good as it gets. No, it was like shining bright, his face. And then his clothes were white, the whitest color of white you've ever seen. I was like, do y'all know what bleach is? Bleach couldn't even do the job. It was brighter than that. So Jesus was like glowing. And then, guess who shows up?
God.
Almost. Hold on. Go back a step. Peter and James and John, they see Moses from the Old Testament, that guy, and Elijah. They're on the mountain, and they're just hanging out with Jesus. Yes, they appear on this mountain. It's wild. I know. So you know what Peter says? This is awesome. We are going to stay here. You get a house. You get a tent. You get a house. We're not leaving. We're going to just live here. But he didn't want to leave. He's like, this is great. And then something else happens. This cloud encircles them. And this cloud begins to speak. Now who appears?
God.
God starts to speak in that cloud. And he says, that guy over there, Jesus, that's my son. And whatever he says, you better listen because it's good stuff. He's the real deal. So it's a pretty amazing mountain story, huh? Yeah. Some pretty awesome things happen on that mountain. So I think it's important for us as followers of Jesus to find a place where we can go and be on a mountain. Because our days are busy, right? Every day. We got places to go, people to see, and homework to finish. Not y'all yet. Y'all, homework.
I got homework.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Yes. So we're just always busy. And then when we actually want to take a break, we want to watch TV or get on our phones or our tablets. So it's always good to get away from that and go to a mountain. Now, you don't have to go to an actual mountain because there's snakes involved and sometimes bears. You don't have to do that. You could just go somewhere where it's quiet and peaceful. And there, you can be with God and you can pray as Jesus did.
I would rather get away from my brother.
Get away from your brother. Exactly. You have to get away from everyone and all the stuff that distracts us. And be with God. And you can even bring your Bible and read scripture. You could do that. And you could do this with your family, too. Y'all can get away, too. But make sure that you try that this week. When you come home, don't go to the TV. Put down that tablet and just go somewhere quiet. Find a mountaintop. Not literally, but just a mountaintop, a place where you can be with God. Okay? Because you'll probably have a really cool experience.
If we go into the clouds, we'll have to throw a piece of yarn down.
Well, let's not go into the clouds. That's not safe. Okay, let's just... All right, but let's say a prayer together. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for mountains and what they mean, the beauty and the awe. But we are really so grateful for those times when we're on top of that mountain with you. Because when we're up there, we become like brand new. So when we have to come back down on the mountain and be in the hustle and bustle of life, you're there with us, keeping us going. Amen. All right, well, we have children's church, so if you are fourth grade enough.
Amen. Amen. Let's continue the singing. You can remain seated for a little bit. Hymn 202, I think we all know this one. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound. And it saved a wretch like me, right? Let's sing that first verse. Why would you make me sing this? we can all stop for a moment and say thanks, right? Because we've all been blessed. We all have things that we do not deserve. And all of it goes to the glory of God. All the glory belongs to Him. It's nothing we've done. It's nothing we've earned. And to God alone be the glory. I'm going to try to get through this verse, and then I hope we can all sing that chorus like we believe it. To God be the glory. How can we say thanks for the things you have done for me? Undeserved things, so undeserved, yet you gave to prove your love for me. The voices of a million angels could not express my gratitude. All that I am and ever hope to be, I owe it all to thee. Can we stand as we sing it today? To God be the glory. To God be the glory. To God be the glory for the things He has done.
Let's go to our Lord in prayer. Father God, Jesus Christ, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, Lord, thank you for this day. Thank you for this room, this house. Thank you for every man, woman, and child that's here today. Lord, thank you that through you, even the ones that's not here, they're going to know. They'll feel the presence of your Spirit. Lord, that's just how you created it. Lord, let us, help us to take you, your name, and your goodness outside these walls and this roof that we call church. Lord, you know, and you've told us time and time again, your church is outside of these walls. Out from under this roof. Lord, it is good to be here amongst friends, family, and loved ones. But there is more love outside these walls and this roof. Lord, this morning, whatever's put in these gold plates, Lord, it may, if it ain't, but for one lost sheep, one lost child to be found again, it's all worth it. Lord, this is a good day to be here. In Christ's name, amen.
Exodus 19:16-20. On the morning of the third day, there were thunders and lightnings, and a thick cloud on the mountain, and a very loud trumpet blast, so that all the people in the camp trembled. Then Moses brought the people out of the camp to meet God, and they took their stand at the foot of the mountain. Now Mount Sinai was wrapped in the smoke because the Lord had ascended on it in fire. The smoke of it went up like the smoke of a kiln, and the whole mountain trembled greatly. And as the sound of the trumpet grew louder and louder, Moses spoke, and God answered him in thunder. The Lord came down on Mount Sinai to the Lord of the to the top of the mountain, and the Lord called Moses to the top of the mountain, and Moses went up. This is the word of the Lord.
There's a place where birds
Thank you, choir, and leading us in that song. Thank you, just week in and week out, however many men and women we have up here, for serving our church and leading us as we worship the Lord. If you have your Bibles with you today, I'd invite you to turn to the Gospel of Luke, chapter 9. Luke, chapter 9. I'm going to be preaching on verses 28 through 36. Luke, chapter 9, verses 28 through 36. If you're able, and if you found your place in God's holy and perfect word, would you please stand for the reading of God's word? Luke chapter 9, verses 28 through 36. Now, about 8 days after these sayings, Jesus took with him Peter and John and James and went up to the mountain to pray. And as he was praying, the appearance of his face was altered, and his clothing became dazzling white. Behold, two men were talking with him, Moses and Elijah, who appeared in glory and spoke of his departure from which he was about to accomplish at Jerusalem. Now Peter and those who were with him were heavy with sleep, but they became fully awake. They saw his glory, and the two men stood with him. And as the men were parting from him, Peter said to Jesus, Master, it is good that we are here. Let us make three tents, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah. Not knowing what he said. And as he was saying these things, a cloud came and overshadowed them, and they were afraid as they entered the cloud. And a voice came out from the cloud saying, This is my son, my chosen one. Listen to him. And when the voice had spoken, Jesus was found alone, and they kept silent and told no one in those days anything of what they had seen. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, would you speak to us now? For we ask this in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Growing up, at least two times a year, my family would make a pilgrimage from Knoxville, Tennessee, where I grew up, to Waynesboro, Virginia, in the heart of the Shenandoah Valley, to visit my grandparents. That's the first thing. When I think about that trip, but the first thing I always think about is getting to the end, hopping out of the car, running up to their front porch and giving my grandmother a hug and a kiss, giving my grandfather a hug and smelling the aftershave, you know, that he had. But even though I was always glad to see them, I always dreaded taking that trip, and there was one reason, the drive. It was 6 hours long. And boys and girls, this was in a day before we had iPads or smartphones. I didn't even have a DVD player. And in case you don't even know what a DVD is, that stands for digital video disc. That's how we used to watch movies. So it was 6 hours of driving that you could use to read or to sleep, maybe to play a game on my Game Boy. We'd listen to music, but you had to we didn't all have our own iPod or iPhone with headphones. We had to, pick one, each person got to pick one CD at a time, and you'd spin them and listen together. And you would wait and wait and wait. I can even remember some of the stops we would take, so I can remember I can picture the bathroom now, the rest area right across the state line into Virginia. And then just a little bit ways past that, there was a McDonald's. And what I remember about it is that they had a Nintendo 64 in the kids' play area. That never worked, but it was still there. I remember those details. It was a drive, I took dozens of times and became familiar with. But something happened whenever I was 18. I just finished my first semester of college. I was back on Christmas break, and we were going up to visit my grandparents. And so we, left Knoxville, drove past Sevierville, got on I-81 to head up past Bristol. And one of the things I remember seeing is looking out the window, and I noticed that there was this ginormous field with hay bales dotting the landscape. There were red barns and silos. In the background, there was a small mountain range, and it was as far as the eye could see. It was absolutely beautiful. That day, I know it was overcast. There was frost on the ground. Even though we were, 4 hours into the drive, there still was frost on the ground. And, the thing about that, what I saw that day, what I noticed, this breathtakingly beautiful scene, is I had seen that scene dozens of times. I even remembered seeing that exact picture, but it didn't take my breath away any time before. Well, I never perceived it in all of its beauty. Before that moment, I always loathed the long drive. Again, loved the destination, loathed the drive. But after that point, I got excited every time I was able to take that drive because I knew what I would be seeing. But what changed? I'd seen that many times before with my own eyes. Well, it wasn't what I saw that changed. It was how I saw. Today, in our text, the inner circle that Jesus has, Peter, James, and John, they see Jesus in a totally different way. They've been with him for some time. You know, probably a couple of years at least. They put in many miles with him, traveling around Galilee, eating meals together, hiking together. And they knew that Jesus was a big deal. I mean, just think about all the things they'd seen him do. They'd seen him heal the sick. They'd seen him cast out demons. They'd heard him teach multiple times. And last week we saw how, even as they had spent all this time with Jesus, their expectations were turned upside down a little bit because Jesus told them that he was the Son of Man. He was God's Messiah who would come to save humanity from their sin by suffering upon a cross, but who would eventually be exalted to the Father's right hand. Moreover, Jesus then called those disciples to do the exact same thing and to follow him to the cross. But the result that they also would share in their Father's glory. But the disciples aren't done. Even though they learned a big lesson, they still haven't learned all that they need to learn. And so today in the text, they actually learn another key thing about Jesus' identity. And again, while it was shocking to hear that the Messiah is actually one who would suffer, Jesus intends to shock them again, because they will learn there's more to Jesus than initially meets the eye. And as we get in our text today, here's what I hope you'll see, that because sin prevents us from seeing properly, God reveals the glory of his Son, Jesus Christ, so that as we follow him in faith, we might see and share in his glory. Let me say that one more time. Because sin prevents us from seeing as we ought, God reveals the glory of his Son, Jesus Christ, to us, so that as we follow him in faith, we will see and share in his glory. In our text today, the disciples are able to see Jesus in a new way. And what they experience is something that they never expected to encounter, although it was with them all along. Well, the first thing that happens in our text today is they see Jesus' glory. They see Jesus' glory. We're told this is about 8 days after Peter had made that confession that you are the Christ of God. And so they've been with Jesus probably stewing on what does that even mean? What are the implications for us as we follow Jesus? And Jesus, we've already met the inner circle one time. You know, Jesus called 12 apostles, he called them, to be the group that followed him most closely. There were a lot more disciples than that, but there were 12. But even from the 12, we get narrowed down to 3. And this is the second time we meet this group, and Jesus has taken them up on a mountain to pray. One of the things that Luke does more than the other Gospels is he shows us times when Jesus goes to pray. And often for Jesus, those are right before significant events. So if you think back to Jesus' baptism at the Jordan River, what we're told in Luke chapter 3 is that as he was praying during the baptism, it says the heavens were opened, and the Holy Spirit descended on him in bodily form like a dove, and a voice came from heaven saying, "You are my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased." There are other times where he prays right before a lot of people come to him for healing. And in chapter 6, before he calls the 12 apostles, it says that he prayed and then he went and he called the 12. Most recently in chapter 9, right before Jesus has this big moment of revelation for the disciples, it says that it happened as he was praying alone and the disciples were with him. And then he asks them, "Well, who do the crowd say that I am?" Again, ultimately this results in Peter's confession that he is the Christ. Fast forward, even all the way into the book of Acts, think about Acts chapter 2 on the day of Pentecost, right? There are 120 disciples gathered in an upper room praying, and it's while they're praying that the Holy Spirit, it says, descends upon them with tongues as of fire. And it changed the world. I want us to think about prayer for just a minute. When you think about prayer, I mean, what is prayer? I think whenever we talk about prayers, the first thing comes to our mind, and probably in what we even pray, is that we pray prayers of intercession. That is, prayers for people who need some type of help, some type of aid from God. we think of our, you know, we, like we did earlier in the worship service, we pray for our health, the health of our loved ones. We pray for people who have a need. And we should absolutely pray those prayers. That is one of the key things that God has given us prayer for. But have you ever thought of prayer as a way of seeing? Prayer as a way of seeing. Prayer, I think, is the chief way in which we exercise our faith. And we can only rightly understand God through prayer. We can see a lot of things through the lens of faith. You know, we can look at different things going on in the world. We can look at the church. We can look at ministry. We can look at one another. But the first thing that we have to see with eyes of faith in prayer is God himself. Praise erupts the moment when we come to God in prayer, asking that he would be with us. That's really what communion with God is. Again, I mentioned this earlier. Sin prevents us from seeing as we ought. We probably all at some point, whether you're old or whether you're young, you probably have seen an episode of Scooby-Doo. And inevitably in that episode, what's going to happen? Velma is going to have her glasses knocked off. She's going to get on her hands and knees, stumbling around. My glasses, I can't see without my glasses. And some of you are the exact same way. You know it, okay? No sense of denying it. My wife is one of those people, okay? Can't see a lick without her glasses. We can't see properly. But we need God to help us see. Psalm 27, verse 4 says this, "One thing I've asked of the Lord, that I will seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life." Listen to this. "To gaze upon the beauty of the Lord, to inquire into his temple." Here's what I think this teaches us about prayer. Prayer is the precondition for seeing Jesus' glory. Let me say that one more time. Prayer is the precondition for seeing Jesus' glory. If we don't approach Jesus in prayer, we can't approach him truly. And so we can only see it if we properly view things through the lens of prayer, through the lens of faith. And remember, prayer is not only the way in which we see Jesus, but it's also the realm of God's action. It's while Jesus is praying that he's baptized and he hears God say, "You are my beloved son with whom I'm well pleased." It's before Jesus calls the disciples. He's praying whenever he calls the disciples. It's whenever the disciples are praying on the day of Pentecost that the Holy Spirit invades and interrupts and descends upon them. So prayer is the realm of God's action. And that's exactly what happens here. Jesus has taken the three up to the mountain to pray. And verse 29 says, "While they were praying, the appearance of his face was altered, and his clothing became dazzling white." Or I like how the NIV says it. It says, "The appearance of his face changed, and his clothes became as bright as a flash of lightning." What's going on? Has Jesus become a ghost or an angel? Or maybe he's up on a mountain. Did the sun hit him just the right way, you know, right behind his head, so he just, the whole thing glows? Oh, what's happening, the Matthew and Mark use this word for it. It's called the transfiguration. Jesus is being transfigured before him. This means that Jesus is temporarily transformed by God into a heavenly being while on earth. It anticipates his future and permanent attainment of glory. This is what's happening at the transfiguration. Jesus is appearing before the disciples in all of his glory. Let's talk for just a minute about what that means. Right? Glory, we might think of that as something like, you know, you're wonderful or you're worthy of praise, and it certainly means that. But in John chapter 17, whenever Jesus prays the high priestly prayer, this is the first thing that he prays. He says, "Father, glorify me in your own presence with the glory that I had with you from before the world existed." So it's something that Jesus already has, and the disciples are just given a way in which the veil is peeled back a little bit so that they could see Jesus for who he truly is. In both the Hebrew and the Greek, the words that are translated for glory in our Bibles, it actually means weight, a heaviness. So if someone is glorious, it means that there's a weight, a weightiness to that person that signifies their importance. The glory of the Lord in particular, it's something that human beings cannot see without being changed forever, even sometimes to death. And that might seem extreme, but return to me to Exodus 19, what Emma read for us right at just a few moments ago. Israel is gathered at the foot of Mount Sinai, and the people are told, don't even go to the foot of the mountain. Don't even touch it, lest you die. And you know, imagine the scene. It's a bit terrifying. But fire descends upon the mountain and smoke, and there's flashes of lightning and peals of thunder. And that is the fearsome presence of God and his glory. Moses alone, of all the people, Moses alone was called up. And then he receives the Ten Commandments from God in chapter 20. And then it says in the next, as he gives the commandments to the people, this is their response. It says, now when all the people saw the thunder and the flashes of lightning and the sound of the trumpet and the mountain smoking, the people were afraid and trembled. They stood far off and said to Moses, you speak to us and we will listen, but don't let God speak, lest we die. God's glory is an overwhelming sense of his sheer holiness. The people, I want you to, let's appreciate something together for just a moment. The people could not go near to God unless he invited them. But John 1 tells us something different happened. John 1 begins, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Fast forward, verse 14. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we have seen what? His glory. Glory as of the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. Glory has come near to us in the person of Jesus. I love that. It's that time of year again, right? Halloween is officially 30 days away. It's October 1st, and that means at Hobby Lobby, they have their Christmas decorations out. One of my favorite Christmas songs was written by Charles Wesley, the brother of the evangelist John Wesley. Hark the Herald Angels Sing. And it's one of the most theological Christmas hymns, and it's also beautiful. But in the second verse, there's this line, veiled in flesh, the Godhead see, hail the incarnate deity. I'm a little nervous about using Jesus to say veiled in flesh in the sense that maybe it's clothes that he puts on and takes off. Once Jesus becomes a human, he's fully human. But here's what I do know, that Jesus was fully God, and on the moment of transfiguration, what that means is revealed to the disciples. They see him as he truly is, fully God and fully human. It's like God has peeled back the lens of heaven so that the disciples can see the heavenly glory of the Son of Man. It's dazzling, confounding, blinding, and astounding. It's the glory of Jesus. And as human beings, that's the glory that we need to see. As disciples of Jesus, it's the glory that we need to see in the face of Jesus. But what's peculiar is we see this exalted picture of Jesus, who, again, is shining as bright as a flash of lightning. He's not the only one there. Verse 30 says this, behold, two men were talking with him, Moses and Elijah. Whenever you see that word behold in your Bible, or maybe look is how it's translated, it's actually a word you need to pay attention to, because it's a word the gospel author is using to direct our attention to what we see. So behold, look, there were two other people there, Moses and Elijah. The two men were talking with him. Moses and Elijah also appeared in glory and spoke of his departure, which he was about to accomplish at Jerusalem. So we need to see Jesus' glory, but this brings me to my second point. We need to see Jesus' glory through the Old Testament lens. Okay, we need to see Jesus' glory through the Old Testament lens. Why are Moses and Elijah present? You might wonder first, how are they present? You know, Moses died in a valley somewhere. Elijah, we're told in 2 Kings chapter 2, he's, you know, taken up into heaven in a chariot of fire, and then he disappears. So why are they here? How are they here? The Bible doesn't give us an exact answer. I just think that God has called him back to heaven to be with Jesus in this moment. But why these two? Why Moses and Elijah? They ministered themselves 600 years apart. Elijah is still 850 years before Jesus. Moses about 1,400 years. But there's several reasons. I'm going to give you three quickly. First, both Moses and Elijah have a mountaintop experience with God. Moses and Elijah have a mountaintop experience with God. So we've already read this. Moses was called up to Sinai. He actually goes up three separate times, actually four throughout his life, to see God on the mountain. All right, Exodus 33 is kind of the last time, and God says, okay, you can come up on the mountain, but if you come up, you can't see my face, because no one can see my face and live. And so we have that scene where Moses is hemmed in between the rocks, and he can't see the front of God, but he can only see the backside of God. It's we sing this in... Oh, I think the hymn is Come Thou Found. It's slipping my mind for just a second. Oh, no. Rock of Ages. Cleft for me. Let me hide myself in thee. It's referring to this fact that we can only see God in Christ. But Moses encounters God on the mountain. Elijah also, in his lowest moment, he's running from Ahab and Queen Jezebel, who wants to seek his life, and he ends up on Mount Sinai, and he encounters God there. And again, he can't see God. We're actually told that he knows the presence of God is there, so he wraps his face in his clothes, and then he goes outside to talk with God. Moses and Elijah saw God on the mountain, but they actually get to see God's face in the face of Jesus. So why Moses and Elijah? They both encountered God on the mountain, and they saw his glory. The second reason is because Moses and Elijah represent the law and the prophets. They represent the entirety of the Old Testament. Moses is the one who received the law on Mount Sinai and gave it to the people. Elijah then is he's kind of the most prominent and the first of all the prophets in their ministry to call Israel to repentance. And Jesus actually said in the Gospel of John, chapter 5, he says, "You search the scriptures because you think that in them you have eternal life, but it is they that bear witness about me." And so, why Moses and Elijah? Because they are representative of the whole Bible bearing witness to Jesus. And finally, I think we could go on other reasons, but I think the third reason that it's Moses and Elijah is that both experienced a form of an exodus. Now, you all know that Moses did. He led Israel away from Egypt, away from Pharaoh, away from enslavement. But Elijah, very curiously, right before his ascension into heaven in 2 Kings chapter 2, we're told that he crosses over the Jordan River, and he crosses over it on dry ground. What an interesting detail to put in there. It's almost as if God wants us to see the pattern of the Exodus even in the ministry of Elijah, who, by the way, also had to proclaim truth to a king who was opposed to God and who was oppressing the people of God. Well, in verse 31, again, it says that they were talking with Jesus about his departure. Well, the Greek word there, translated departure, it's literally the word exodus. They were speaking to Jesus about his exodus. Now, that word is sometimes used to someone leaving the room, right? I'm going to make my exit. It's sometimes used euphemistically to refer to someone's death. But it's also referring to this climactic event about the things that would happen in Jerusalem, we're told. Right, Jesus' death for us is a second exodus, where Jesus is freeing us from the cruel masters of sin and death in order that we might have life in him. Look at where we're at in the Gospel of Luke. We're in the middle of chapter 6. We're in a precipice of some regard, not only because they're on a mountain, but because in just a few verses, what we're going to be told is that Jesus set his face towards Jerusalem. Well, let's roll the tape forward. It's not for another 14 chapters that Jesus will die on the cross. And yet we're already here near the beginning of the book, about not even halfway through, and we're prepared that Jesus is going to depart in Jerusalem. He's going to have an exodus in Jerusalem. So the law and the prophets, they bear witness to the glory of this great act of salvation. Well, this overwhelms the disciples. Verse 32 tells us that they kind of almost fell asleep, but they were able to stay awake while the glory was there. And Peter, you know, he starts talking out of his head. You know, it's almost like he doesn't quite know what to do, so he just starts talking. Some of us do that. You get nervous. You just keep talking. And he says, "Okay, Lord, let's do this. I'm going to build three tents, three tabernacles, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." What? Is Peter trying to capture the glory and ecstasy of the moment? Does he want to build? Is he imagining that there are three divine beings in front of him who all need to be worshipped? We're not sure. But here's what we do know. In the midst of Peter's confusion, God still speaks. The glory cloud, it says, hovered over the disciples and says, once again, "This is my beloved son, my chosen one." This brings me to my final point today. We not only need to see, or my chosen one, listen to him. My final point, we not only need to see Jesus' glory, we need to obey Jesus' glory. We need to obey Jesus' glory. Remember, Jesus' glory is something that he shares with the Father, but it also means that he shares the authority of the Father. And notice how important God's pronouncement is. He shows and tells us exactly what we need to hear, exactly what Peter, James, and John needed to hear. Jesus Christ is his chosen one. That means that he's the one whom God loves. Remember last week we noticed whenever Jesus said that he would be the Son of Man who would suffer, be rejected, and die, how he was saying that he was going to take on the ministry of the suffering servant from Isaiah 53. Well, this is actually repeating that, but a different servant song in Isaiah 42, which says, "Behold my servant whom I uphold, my chosen one in whom my soul delights. I put my spirit upon him, and he will bring forth justice to the nations." The servant will save, the servant will reign. And what does it mean then for us to obey Jesus in his glory? Well, I think the first thing it means is that we obey Jesus whatever he says. Okay, we are. If Jesus is our Lord, then we are his servants. If he is God, then he has all authority, and we should acknowledge that. The second thing it means is that we obey Jesus' first command. Right? In the Gospel of Mark, the very first thing out of Jesus' mouth is repent and believe, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. If we are to listen to Jesus' words, we must be a people who repent of our sins. And third, it means that we should grow in our faith as disciples as we continue to make disciples. Go with me to the Great Commission. We all know it. Go ye therefore into all the world, making disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. Sounds a lot like God's words. This is my beloved Son, my chosen one. Listen to him. The commands of Jesus for us are imperative. We shouldn't reduce the scope of Jesus' authority to one aspect of our life, as in like what we do at church, or as it concerns spiritual matters, but nothing else. If Jesus is Lord, he is Lord over all. We can't give him just any small portion. He gets all of it. And in each of our lives, we might have an experience like Peter. Right? Nikki talked about this earlier. We have moments that are like those mountaintop experiences. But what this is telling us is that our religious experience needs to be translated into righteousness. Right? Ecstasy needs to be transformed into obedience. Right? It's not uncommon to find people who go chasing one religious high to the next. They want to feel something very powerfully all the time. But if you read the Bible, anybody who has an experience of God's glory only sees it through much suffering. In moments of trial, moments of testing, moments of failure, moments of restoration. Right? Whenever Elijah encountered God upon the mountain, he was so depressed that he wanted to take his own life. But then he encountered God. And you know what? He still had work to do after that. Every experience of glory that we might have in this life will eventually come to an end. Look at verse 36. It says that after these things, Jesus was standing alone. Right? Moses and Elijah are gone. There's this Lord whom we've seen. They have to go back down the mountain. But as we obey the glorious Lord Jesus Christ, we do so with the assurance that one day we will experience that glory as well. And whenever we do, we will experience it forever. We need to see glory, right? We need a glimpse of glory, but we need more than that. Here's what C.S. Lewis says in his sermon, The Weight of Glory. It's one of my favorite sermons I've ever read. I've not heard it preached, just read, but it's amazing. He says this, "We don't want to merely see beauty, though God knows even that is bounty enough. We want something else which can hardly be put into words. To be united with the beauty that we see, to pass into it, to receive it into ourselves, to bathe in it, to become a part of it." Peter, James, and John saw the glory of Jesus on the mountain, but here's the paradox of the cross. The place in which we see God's glory in Christ more than any other place is at the moment of his weakness, the moment of shame, at the moment of death upon the cross. In John chapter 3, verse 15, it says, "Just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so the Son will be lifted up. He'll be exalted to the cross. And everyone who believes in him will have eternal life." The cross is the place where the glory of Jesus is on display for all the world to see. Remember this, because sin prevents us from seeing as we ought. God reveals the glory of his Son, Jesus Christ, to us, in order that as we follow him in faith, we will see and share in his glory. Again, it's key that we not only see it, but we share in it. Whenever Moses came down from the mountain, in Exodus 34, we're told that his face was shining so brightly that the people made him wear a veil for the rest of his life because he was reflecting the glory of the Lord. But the Apostle Paul, reflecting upon this moment as it relates to us seeing Jesus Christ, in 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 18, he says, "And we," this is in the future, "and we, with unveiled face, beholding the glory of the Lord, are being transformed in the same image from one degree of glory to another. This comes from the Lord, who is the Spirit." The glory of Jesus that the disciples saw on the mountain, we can experience now, but we will experience it forever one day. Think forward to that new Jerusalem. At that time, whenever there is no more mourning, nor crying, nor pain, or death anymore. Revelation 21, verse 23 says, in the new Jerusalem there will have no moon nor sun, for the glory of the Lord gives it light, and its lamp is the Lamb. No longer will there be anything accursed, but the throne of God and of the Lamb will be in it, and his servants will worship him. They will see his face, and his name will be written on their foreheads. Night will be no more. They will need no light, nor lamp, nor sun. For the Lord God will be their light, and they will reign forever and ever. This is the future that is promised for us in Christ. And it may not feel like it right now. You might be discouraged. You might feel the weight of your sin. You might feel unworthy. But the Bible tells us, Pat shared this earlier, we are unworthy in God's sight, but he has made us worthy. Right? The glory that we feel like we don't deserve, the glory that we can't put on display, God is working that glory in our lives. C.S. Lewis goes on to say in The Weight of Glory that if even the most mundane, ordinary human being who you would never suspect of it one day will be transformed into a being so glorious that if you were to see it right now, you would be tempted to worship him. This is the glory that we are called to. Not that God would transform us into lesser gods, but that he would conform us to be his people. And that ultimately we would see him. One thing that I would ask, that I would seek, that I would gaze upon your beauty in the temple of the Lord, and that I would dwell there forever. This is the beauty that we can see in Christ. I mentioned this also. It begins by faith. It starts in prayer. I'm going to be standing down front in just a moment. And if anyone needs to pray to receive the Lord Jesus Christ, to come unto him in faith, I would love to talk to you. And maybe walking down front is not your thing. The Bible never says you have to walk down front. If you need to talk to me later on, if you need to have a conversation with me or someone else, call upon the Lord. He is ready and waiting, able to forgive. I don't know if you feel like you've made too many mistakes and you don't qualify. Well, guess what? In Jesus Christ, you're qualified. Maybe you feel like you need to get your act together. Once I've fixed all the problems in my life, once I've stopped doing the wrong things, then I belong. But the Spirit is ready to work in your life. If you try to fix yourself, you'll fail. That's how it always works. But if you come to the Lord, depending upon his grace, held firm to the rock of ages, then you can enjoy God forever. You can let him do the work in your life by his Holy Spirit working in you. There is freedom, joy, and life forevermore. If you would, please bow your heads with me. Let's pray. God, we need to see you. But so often our eyes are looking at other things. We can be so easily distracted by things, God, things that aren't always bad, but things that are not you. As C.S. Lewis said, we would rather splash around in a puddle in the slums, playing in the mud, whenever we've been offered a holiday at sea. All we have to do is come to you in faith. So God, I pray you would help us to take time in our lives to see Jesus for who he is. Because once we see him for who he is, our lives will forever be changed. God, I pray that you would help us to not worry about what the cost is to follow Jesus Christ, because we've already promised that if whatever we lose, God, you would give us back tenfold. But we need you to work in our hearts. We need you to transform us. And I pray that you would do this here at First Baptist Church of Williams. As we're transformed from one degree of glory into the next, would you continue to take us higher, God? Continue to conform us into the image of your Son, Jesus Christ. That we would know him, love him, and enjoy him forever and ever. In And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Would you stand?
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of his spirit, washed in his blood. This is my story. This is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, perfect delight. Visions of rapture now burst on my sight. Angels descending bring from above echoes of mercy, whispers of love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long.
May be seated. It's been a joy to have everyone here today. I wanted to make one note about that song. Fanny Crosby was the author of that hymn, and you may not know her name, but you know her songs. Our songbook is riddled with hymns that Fanny Crosby wrote in the 1800s. One detail that you should know about Fanny Crosby is that she was blind. She was unable to see. But she penned that second verse. Perfect submission, perfect delight, visions of rapture now burst upon my sight. It was something that she looked forward to see on that day whenever the Lord Jesus resurrects her. Thank you for coming today. I hope you and pray you have a joyful week. Continue to be mindful as we are God's presence in the world, the salt and light of Jesus Christ. And I pray you would go forward in the peace of Christ. So would you please bow your head with me? Let's say just one more word. God, would you be with us as we go? Keep us safe. God, give us your joy wherever we may go. As we encounter people who are hurting, would you help us to be a comfort? Whenever we encounter people who are in need, would you help us, Father, to be the hands and feet of Jesus in that moment. God, give us joy along the way. You promised that you would. You are faithful. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thank you. Have a good week.